constant through the trial and the change. This one thing, it remains. This one thing, it remains. Your love never fails, it never gives up, it never runs out on me.
Good morning, everybody. Ooh, that's so loud. So I want to welcome everybody. Can we just pause? That is so amazing that God's love never runs out, never gives up. What's the third one?
Never runs out.
Oh, it is runs out again? Never fails. I would start singing it because then I would know it, but you don't want to hear that. Leave it to Miss Cindy. So can we just quiet ourselves just for one moment? Can everybody, wherever you are, even if you're standing, just stop. And I want us to breathe in together. God's love never fails. It never gives up. It never runs out. On me. On the person sitting next to me. On this world. On the people around the world. God's love never stops, never gives up. Just breathe that in. God, thank you for that love. You know, it's so important for us to pause throughout our day, throughout our life, throughout moments, just to breathe that in at times. And how important it is to breathe that in difficult times, that God, right here, where it's difficult in my life, your love never gives up on me. Never. Amen. So I want to welcome you to Cornerstone Christian Fellowship. I'm Pastor Tracy, and I'm the lead pastor here at Cornerstone. We're so glad you're with us today. And today is a very special, special day. It's so loud, Joan. Okay. It's a special, special day because we have new members being welcomed into our congregation. So we're going to invite the new members to come on up. Billion. We're missing some people. Oh, here they come. Aren't they beautiful? They're so good looking. You can be here. You're perfect. All right. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to start with you, Debbie, and I'm going to ask who I called Barbara for the first 2 months that she was here. And then suddenly she looked at me one day and said, I'm Debbie. And I'm like, okay. I think I called you something different,
Brandon.
Too. Brandon. Yeah, I called him. Hey, help me here. Exactly. So I'm going to ask them to introduce themselves and tell why they're here and if there's anything they want to share. Yep, you need the mic.
Hi, my name is Debbie Avila, not Barbara Avila.
Yeah, exactly.
And I'm here at the encouragement of my daughter who's watching online from San Antonio. Hey, Mandy. She encouraged me to step out of my comfort zone and come to Cornerstone. And I will tell you that I have found healing, and I have found acceptance, and I really have found love from this group of people. Aww. And I look forward to growing in my faith and worshiping with this wonderful, diverse community of believers. And I thank you.
Amen.
Okay. My name is Brian. Most of you know who I am, so I'm not going to introduce myself. I want to talk about two reasons why I want to become a member. The first reason is because recently I started watching the podcast or listening to the podcast. If you guys are new members and you haven't listened to the podcast, specifically Sophia's story, you will find out what happened when the church chose to become inclusive. Sophia, you're hopefully watching online. I just want to thank you for your bravery, Pastor Tracy, for the wisdom to know what direction the church needed to go in, and all of the The leadership that chose to stay when you all changed the church. I want to thank you, all of you guys, and everybody who's reached out to me. I'm super not articulate right now. I had all these things I was going to say. But when you make something more diverse, you make it more beautiful, infinitely more beautiful. And you all know, whether you know this or not, in changing the church to be more inclusive, you helped people you haven't even met yet. You helped me. You did it back in 2019, whenever it was. You helped me. I didn't even care about going to church back in 2019. But I would have never come here if it wasn't for the changes that were made. And I know that 40% of the congregation left, and that must have been incredibly painful. But I just want to thank everyone who had anything to do with that, whether I get a chance to meet you or I don't get a chance to meet you, or there were people here that maybe I'll never meet, you know. But and then the other reason is that you all, a lot of you, whether you know it or not, in big or little ways, you know about my, a lot of you guys know about my mental health struggles, but you all have saved me in big and little ways. So there's a lot of stuff that goes into why I'm still here, why I'm still here on this earth, but the church is a big reason for it. So why wouldn't I want to stand with you guys? Why wouldn't I want to stand fearlessly with you guys? So just like loving others fearlessly, I'm going to stand fearlessly with you guys. But I'm going to shut up because I've been talking way too long. So,
Sarah.
Hi, I'm Sarah.
That was sweet.
I was sent here by a friend of mine, and from the first moment I stepped into the building, I instantly felt the presence of the Holy Spirit, and I have cried pretty much every service, the entire service since. So you guys all probably see me with the tissues and makeup down my face every single Sunday. But this community has welcomed me in a way that I have never experienced before in a church, and I just love every single person here. I love getting to know everybody, and it is very diverse, and it just, like Brian said, it just makes it more beautiful. I love when Piper is doing her amazing artwork, when people are dancing. I just love that this church accepts just however you worship, however you want to worship God, and it's just amazing to be here, and this is definitely my permanent home.
Hi, I'm Krista. I've been coming here off and on for like 2 years, and I really decided that I wanted to become an official member and be here in person. I struggle a little bit with social anxiety, so this is very nerve-wracking, but like Sarah said, everyone has been so welcoming, like the way people come up to you and say hello, good morning. Like growing up, I didn't have a church that was as welcoming like that. And I really just want to build my relationship with God and my higher power. I just want to grow closer and I want to learn more. I have so much to learn, so I'm really happy to be here, and that's it. Thank you.
Good morning. I am Brittany, and this is Billion. We've been coming here for almost 2 years now. I love Cornerstone. I love being here. I love that we don't have to shrink. We can be ourselves. And you guys just love on us since day one. You have anything you want to say?
No.
Okay. We love coming here. Sandra is my wife, and it's just an amazing place to be. We feel the love. We're happy to be here, and we are glad to be members. We love hearing the different perspective from all the different speakers every Sunday and learning and growing with you guys.
Hi, everybody. My name is Cindy, and my story started, the way I found my way to Cornerstone started in 1970, before the church was here. And it was because I had my first job. I was as nervous as anything, 10th grader. I was a nurse's aide in Friends Hall, and I had the pleasure of meeting sweet Sandy Hawkins.
Aww.
And after that, a number of years later, who would come walking into the shop I was working in but Sandy and her sister Cindy. And one of the things Sandy said on my first day to me was, she could tell I was nervous. She said, you know, you're gonna mess up, but don't worry, don't worry. Just if you need anything, I got your back. And when I met Cindy, I got that same, I got your back feeling. And when I walked into this church and met everybody, and especially the main reason we're here is for Jesus and for God, and guess who's got my back here? Yeah. So, thank you.
Amen. Thank you. So I'm going to invite the elders to come on forward, wherever you are, and we're going to pray over. You all can put your hands forward, and we're going to pray over our new members. Not you guys, this group. You all. All right. All right. Miss Cindy, do you want to pray over the new members?
Thank you, Lord. Thank you. Heavenly Father, we do come this morning, and we say thank you. We thank you for the new members, dear God. And before I've asked of anything, Lord, I take back all ground from Satan, who will try his best to discourage them, Lord. And I lift them up to you, dear God. I pray fresh anointing over each and every one of them, dear God. Lord, I ask that you deliver them from anything that has kept them to get closer to you over the years, dear God. We thank you for the doors being open to Cornerstone, dear God. We thank you for loving fiercely, dear God. We thank you for welcoming people as they are. And Father God, we thank you, Lord, for how you continue to use this place as a saving grace for some people, dear God. How you have brought them up out of the muck and miry clay, dear God, and how right this day you're setting their feet upon a rock, and that rock is you, and nobody can take that away from them, dear God. So, Lord, as they are on their new journey at a new church, dear God, we ask that you open up their hearts, dear God. We ask that you continue to order their steps so that they will be pleasing to you and others. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. Amen. Give them a hand. Can we have some new member music behind as they return to their seats, Dave? Thank you all.
Thank you.
Oh. There you go. Give him another hand. All right. Thank you. Yeah, you just stand.
Where does the walking music come from?
So I'm going to invite us this morning, you know, just thinking about the call to worship and thinking about what's going on in the world. There's a lot of things that just feel just wild and out of control. So I'm going to invite us to stand together. And before we go into worship, I want us to pray over the Middle East. And I want us, you know, whatever political views, whatever side you stand on, whatever is going on, you know, the thing that we have to remember is they are people. And they are loved by God. And what is happening there is not love. And it's not loving fearlessly. And the only one who can touch what's going on and touch those lives and the pain of those lives is God. It's moments like that that I have to say, Lord, have mercy. Lord, that they would know that your presence is there. So I'm going to invite two or three people just to pray your heart and pray God's mercy. And you can just pray out loud. Whoever has it on their heart to pray. One more. Lord, we thank you for your love. We thank you for your love that extends over heinous situations. And I think about Jesus on the cross. Forgive them, they know not what they do. Huh. How often do we do things that we do not know what we are doing? I pray that you would open the eyes of those that are directing both sides. Open the eyes, their eyes, that they would see the humanity of the other. That they would see that they are people. That they would see the beauty. That they would see the children. That they would see the families. I think of loving fearlessly. I think of what it means to be a centered set community, and that means that we don't put things into boxes and die on that box because of our theology or because of our belief. but that we follow after you and your love. So, Lord, we pray, have mercy over the Middle East. Have mercy over this world. Have mercy even in the Ukraine and what's going there on there. Have mercy on your people, Lord. And may your kingdom rise up. And may your kingdom prevail. And may we learn hate never drives out hate, but only love. So, Lord, as we come in to worship this morning, we come in, we set burdens at your feet. We set this world at your feet. We lay those concerns that we have at your feet. And we take this time together as a community to fix our eyes and fix our hearts and fix our minds on you as we worship this morning. Thank you. Thank you that we carry within us the juxtaposition of new members and the beauty and the glory of that, while we hold this other in our hands as well. And we bring them both to you. We pray all of this, Lord, in Jesus' name. Let's worship together, church.
Seated above, enthroned in the Father's love, destined to die, poured out for all mankind. God's only Son, perfect and spotless one. He never sinned, suffered as if he did. And all authority, every victory is yours. All authority, every victory. Suffered as if he did.
Figure.
God, this is the terrain where we are. This is the environment where we come into. Where all the stuff that we see, all the stuff that we experience, all the stuff we came in with, all the stuff we left at home, and we still carry with us, it's still here, and sometimes it's so hard to just leave it behind. And sometimes we can't, we carry it with us. God, you know that is part of the environment of where we are walking. God, you come in. You breathe through us. You move through us. You bring your breath and... God, that's been my prayer this morning, is that all of the terrain, all of the environment moves with your breath, God. Moves with the wind of your spirit. That all of the grass, all of the leaves shake in the wind. Every limb of every tree bends. God, you are with us. You're with us all. Whether we know it or not, whether we see it or not, rather. We experience you in our environment. We experience you with us. God, give us eyes to see that this morning. God, give me eyes to see that this morning.
Faithful.
need you guys to sing that second verse with me. Here we go. Your faithfulness, I will rest in your promises, my confidence is your faithfulness and faith. Past this moment. So we've all had people break their promises on us. Big or small. How much it makes us wail.
Sometimes it'd be like that.
we can count on God to keep his promises to us. Your faithfulness, I will rest in your promises. My confidence is your faithfulness.
Yes. This moment is so sweet. It is so sweet just to rest in that. To be mindful of your goodness, God, your faithfulness, God. To remind ourselves that you do not fail and that you do not break your promises. And that your greatest promise is that you will remain with us in every moment, in every situation. Through the highest of highs and the lowest of lows, you remain with us. Your presence is the greatest gift you give to us, and is the greatest gift that we can give back to you. And so just leaning into moments like this one, it's the greatest offering that we can offer back to you. This is the relationship that you created us for and created us into and created us out of. And becoming one with you in this time of relationship is the greatest reintegration that we could offer you. I'm so grateful for this place and for all of you, and for each of you new members that have found your way to us. I'm grateful that we exist as a place that can be, well, at least that aims to be worthy of all those beautiful things you said about us. And we are grateful that you are here to become part of all those wonderful things, and you're as much a part of it as any of us are. We all make this place the diverse, beautiful place that it is. Every one of us, whether this is your first time ever checking us out, or whether you've been here since the foundations of this place, being this place. And each of us are important and have a role we can play, many roles we can play. And one of those is this time that we're going to move into of offering. And I say that without an ounce of manipulation, without an ounce of, you know, trying to force anything. This place exists because of the generosity of this body, because of the generosity of all of us. All of us coming together, just like they've done since the beginning, and pooling our resources together to say we believe that this is important work, that this place is an important place. Those kids are just as welcome here. They're fine. Their joy is welcome in this place too. We as parents need to be reminded of that because we're very self-conscious of that. But yes. So yes, as we move into this time of offering, we just invite you, if you love this place, if you are someone who believes in the vision and the ministry and the mission of this place, believes in the beauty of this place, we invite you to give just wherever you're able, in whatever ways you're able, in whatever capacity you're able, with the belief that when we all come together to do that, there will be enough. So yes, God, we pray over this time. We do ask for you to put your hand over this offering and to bless it and to multiply it in ways beyond our even imagination. Again, trusting in your goodness and believing in faith that you are enough, and out of your generosity, there is enough in this place, and that you will continue to provide ways greater than our ways for us to remain in this place in the ways that you're calling us to remain and to be and to continue to love in this place. Amen. There are lots of ways that you can give. If you're one of the newer people to this church, there are lots of ways. We put them on the screen for anyone at home. You can see them as well. Thank you. And now we want to invite all of those children to Kingdom Kids. You can hang out with one another, fellowship with one another. Yeah, you too. Yep. You can meet in the back. Miss Rashida's back there. And then we also have youth having Bible study during this time. So if you are a youth in grades 6 through 12, yes, 6 through 12. 6 through 12, we invite you to fellowship with one another during this time as well. You can meet in the back as well with Miss Tassaday. There's a place and a space for all of us. And all of us who remain in this room, there's a place for us too. A beautiful time we're going to move into. We're going to open the Word together, hear what that has to say together, discover together what it is that God has for us this morning. And our shepherd through that time this morning is our pastor, Pastor Tracy, who we're so blessed to have. So we want to invite her up. Thank you.
You know, I can't help but think of how prophetic. Well, look how well you did that, Kevin. My Lord. Usually I'm like... But I can't think of how prophetic that moment was of that little child screaming, right? We're singing about faithfulness and confidence, and that our confidence is in God's faithfulness. And I think about how often, now be honest with me, how often we can get into what I call those dark spaces, the abyss of our life, and we lose our confidence in God's faithfulness. And really what's going on in us is we're screaming like that little child back there, going like, where are you? What's going on? And I think about, you know, this week, I hit one of those moments, and I sat at breakfast with my good friend, and... This is important because I sat with her and I'm like, and another thing, and wasn't that what I sounded like? But here's the what happens in those moments. Is we lose sight of God in the midst of how we're feeling yucky. We lose sight of God's faithfulness. And she looked at me in the middle of it, and God bless her, because she didn't, you know, do any of the Christianese stuff. Thank you, Joan. But she went, all I hear is non-negotiables. She goes, all I hear is you putting yourself into this box of non-negotiables that you can't move from. She goes, you got to broaden. Think outside of the box. Broaden what you're saying. And that was it. You know, it wasn't the lecture. It wasn't, you shouldn't feel like this. It wasn't that. It was just, you're collapsing yourself into a mindset, into a thought process that God is still there. And it was, she didn't even say God is still there. She just went, you got non-negotiables. That was enough for me, right? To go, I got non-negotiables. I got to switch the way I'm thinking. But the reason that I bring that up is because our confidence is not in people. It's not in even our circumstances. Our confidence is in God. That God is faithful. And the other part, too, of that, find somebody that can journey with you in the abyss. Find somebody that isn't going to give you the Christian berk-a-berk. That's what I'm going to do now when I want to swear, berk-a-berk. Isn't going to give you that Christian stuff, but they're going to look at you and give you just a wisdom and come alongside and be able to... I looked at her, now I want to cry. And be able, right? Isn't that so true? I can't help it. And be able to just journey with you, non-judgmentally. Because we're all there. Anybody hit those abysses? Come on, we all do. We all do. So I think today, although I might have blown it right now, but I think today we might have a miracle. Because for the last 2 weeks, I haven't been here. My family's been visiting for my husband and my 40-year anniversary. We just celebrated it October 8th. The miracle is I still like him after 40 years. Hallelujah. But so I missed the last two Sundays because my family came out. Beautiful, beautiful time together. But the first Sunday, Natalia, who lives with us, came walking in the door at 11:35. And I'm like, is church over? And she goes, yeah. And I'm like, wow. Okay, but I thought it was a fluke. And then the next week, she came home, and it was like 11:32. And I'm like, is church over again? And she's like, yes. And I'm like, good Lord, what am I doing? I can't help myself. So as I was preparing my sermon this morning, it's all I got. Usually I have 7 or 8 pages. It's all I got. Why are y'all clapping? So we're going to see how this goes today. So, you know, this is one of my verses that is a go-to verse. And so we are preaching in Choose Your Own Adventure. And there are certain verses that I have that I've always wanted to preach on, but we've just never landed there. This is one of them. I actually was in a conversation with Pastor Bob once, and he talked about this verse. And I went, my Lord, there's something in there. And it just stood out to me. It's been years. And recently, I'm going back through Genesis, and I read this verse again, and I just went, this is what I want to preach on. And it's so simple, and it's so short, but we're going to go for it, because I think it's also so profound. So let's turn, if you have a Bible. If not, you can look it up on your phone, or just look up. We're going to start in Genesis 11, verse 27. This is the account of Terah. I saw the shadow. I thought somebody was coming behind me. I'm sorry. Terah became the father of Abram, Nahor, and Haran. And Haran became the father of Lot. While his father Terah was still alive, Haran died in Ur of the Chaldeans in the land of his birth. Abram and Nahor both married, and the name of Abram's wife was Sarai, and the name of Nahor's wife was Milcah. She was the daughter of Haran, the father of both Milcah and Iscah. Now Sarai was barren, and she had no children. Terah took his son Abram, his grandson Lot of Haran, and his daughter-in-law Sarai, the wife of his son the wife of his son Abram, and together they set out from Ur of the Chaldeans to go to Canaan. But when they came to Haran, they settled there. Hold on to that. They set out from Ur of the Chaldeans to go to Canaan, but when they came to Haran, they settled there. Terah lived 205 years, and he died in Haran. One of the things I find fascinating about this is that this is Terah's life. Two paragraphs. And within those two paragraphs is they were going to Canaan, but when they came to Haran, they settled. Hold on to that. Genesis 12. The Lord had said to Abram, "Leave your country and your people and your father's household and go to the land I will show you. I will make you into a great nation, and I will bless you, and I will make your name great, and you will be a blessing. I will bless those who bless you, and whoever curses you, I will curse. And all the peoples on earth will be blessed through you." So Abram left, as the Lord had told him, and Lot went with him. And Abram was 75 years old when he set out from Haran. He took his wife Sarai, his nephew Lot, all the possessions they had accumulated and the people they had acquired in Haran, and they set out for the land of Canaan, and they arrived there. What is so interesting about this story is, why did Terah stop? Why did he not keep going? His goal was Canaan, but he settled in Haran. He had it in his head to go to Canaan. What might have been different if he would have kept going to the land of Canaan? What might have been different if he didn't settle? What's your Haran? What's your place of settling? What's your place of not moving on? When I think about this, God calls Abram out of Haran to go to Canaan, which was the place that his father felt in his heart to go to. What areas in our life do we just settle? Do we get tired? Do we quit? Do we get complacent? Maybe we stop to recharge or to replenish. And then we kind of just get comfortable and we stop moving. And I'm not talking about big things. I'm talking about those little decisions that we also make. Those things that we've held within our hearts that we just kind of move away from. We forget about. We just stop moving. And that keeps us from getting where we intended to go. What's your Haran? Where in your life have you settled? Where in your life have you just kind of stopped? So this morning for me is about helping us walk through the areas of our life and to kind of assess, where have I stopped moving? Where have I stopped moving forward? And I'm not talking about dreams. I'm not talking about promises. I'm not even talking about vision. Because the truth is that God oftentimes simply moves through the mundane. With Terah just felt to go to Canaan. Terah made that decision to go to Canaan, and then he just got comfortable. You know, there are times that we set up a tent with stakes and pegs in the ground. We were talking about this as elders, and Matt said this. And we're not supposed to put those pegs in the ground. We're supposed to keep moving. Where have we stopped moving? Where have you stopped moving in your life? Where have we been inspired and now it just falls flat? There's no more movement. I think about Proverbs 6:10. A little sleep, a little slumber, a little folding of the hands to rest, and poverty will come on you like abandoned, and scarcity like an armed person. Where have we just kind of slowed down? You know, I think about this in regards to dishes. If you ever come to my house, you'll see that after we get done eating, pretty quick after we get done, and sometimes people are still eating, I get up from the table and immediately do the dishes. And I'll tell you why. Because if I don't, yeah, thank you, Brandon. If I don't do that, they won't get done. And then when I force myself, and this is, it's a force, because I hate dishes. Dishes are not fun. But Tony does all the cooking, so then I feel obligated to do the dishes. It's the least thing I can do. So I get up, and I grab that first dish, and it feels like a giant anvil in my hand of 10,000 pounds. As I pick it up and be like, I gotta put it in the dish. I don't like it, right? But I just get up and I begin to do it. Because if I didn't, dishes would be piled everywhere. That's what not settling looks like. And for me, that's what movement looks like. It's these little decisions we make that we go, I gotta keep moving. Even though this is hard. And even though this is something that is difficult for me to do, I'm going to pick up that first dish and I'm going to start to move. Where is your Haran? And you know, it's so interesting because to me, the whole imagery of the tabernacle in the desert, the whole imagery of the Old Testament is about movement. But what we do as Christians is we want to set up house. We want to build a building. And that's what the Israelites said. We don't like walking in the desert anymore, God. We want to build you a structure. And God said, I never asked you for a structure. But we build these structures. Where have you settled in Haran when God is inviting you to continue to move to Canaan, where God is inviting you to keep putting one foot in front of the other and keep moving? So this is what I want to do. I want to hand out little cards. Do you have the cards? Okay. And I want us to look at different areas in our life. And this is what I want. Could you put the next slide up? These are just a few areas, but we could have stopped moving at personal development, taking care of our mental health, or location, maybe it is where we live, or physical, our health, our weight, our exercises, that we used to go to the gym, or we used to walk, and all of a sudden we stopped. Our career, hobbies that we used to love to do, but all of a sudden we just stopped one day. We just kind of left it. Or our spiritual growth, our soul development. How about just being nice, being a good person, being a team player, being a gracious person? Maybe it's travel, maybe it's education, maybe it's in giving, maybe it's in just all of these different areas. Maybe it's devotionals or serving or drawing or painting or praying or writing, just all of these different areas in our life. I want to invite us to walk through the areas of our life and to prayerfully ask God, where have I set a tent and laid the pegs when I'm supposed to still be moving? Does that make sense? I believe in the depth of my soul that God is always whispering to us, keep moving, keep going, don't stop. So I'm going to ask whoever's at the back, put on a little music, and I'm going to give us like 5 minutes to sit and to think. And these cards are important. Write down on these cards. If there's not an area in your life where you feel like you've stopped, that's all right. Go, I'm still moving. That's fine. Don't have to do that. But I want you to just take a minute and write down, where is your haran? Where do you feel like you have settled in an area of your life when God is whispering, keep going? noticed that Abram was 75 years old. I don't care how old you are. I don't care how young you are. God is forever whispering, come on, keep going. Don't stop. There is always God's purpose and God's vision for our life, no matter how old or young that we are. There is always God's invitation that whispers, keep moving. Don't set up camp. Just keep going, one day at a time. Life is fluid, and the invitation is to keep moving. So, this is what I want us to do with what we have. In the Old Testament, and I so believe that the Old Testament, all of it, is about movement and is about continuing forward. And in the Gospels, we see it, Ephesians, Thessalonians, Peter. We are repeatedly invited to remain alert, to pray. God is forever saying, be alert. Be open. Listen to my voice. I believe that is so key in our life, is to remain in that space of listening, of being present to the now, of being proactively seeking God, of proactively listening, of being awake. It is so easy in this world to be complacent. It is so easy to turn on Netflix or any other thing and to veg out. It's so easy to do that. It's so easy to just curl up, to be tired, non-active. And sometimes, slowly, those whispers, that drive, that perseverance, just kind of fade. It just fades because we lose that alertness. We lose that perseverance. We lose the vision. We lose the goals that we had. We lose the dreams that we had. We lose the idea that my life is about me making the choices that I'm making. It's not just about God waving God's magic wand over our life, but it is about us in the dance with God, following and listening. But we live our lives out. We make the choices on what we do and live our lives. So this is what I want to do next. Do you have the papers, honey? You're working hard today. Oh, you all got them already? Yeah, you guys got them. Oh, David handed them out. This side has them. That side doesn't have them. Rut-row, hon. Rut-row. Dave was ahead of the game. David! Woo! Okay, you don't have them. Never forget what I said. Forget it. I love us. This is why I love us so much. So I'm putting this very practical tool in your hand. Can I tell you? There was such a time in my life where it was like, okay, I would do these things, I would pray about it, and then I would wait for God to do something. And then one day, many years ago, I had an epiphany. Oh, wait, I pray about it, then I got to do it. Right? There's practical tools that we have in this world that help us do things. So this is the SMART goals. And I want you to take out of what you've written one that stands out to you. One that is one that you want to look at and work on. And I want you to put that on this piece of paper and write down a specific goal. Now, What is important about this goal is that it must be achievable, which is the A in SMART. It must be achievable. So like, don't write 7 days a week, I'm gonna get up at 5 and I'm gonna run 3 miles. Don't do that. It's not gonna work. It could be something as simple as one day out of this next week, I'm going to, or I'm gonna make an appointment with the doctor, or I'm gonna start reading a book, or whatever it might be. Just make a specific, well-defined, clear, and unambiguous. What that means is it's not ethereal. It is clear and concise. And then it has to be something that is measurable, so that you can look and to say, look, at the end of the week or what have you, I've actually done this, that you can check it off. And again, needs to be achievable, realistic, and I left the T off on mine with a clearly defined timeline. So you're including a start date and a target date. Thank you. So I want you to take another 3 minutes, and I'm going to give you 3 minutes on this, or five. I'm going to see who's writing. And I want you to take one thing that you wrote down and work off of that. All right? Can we have music? Cue music. And then we're going to do something with this, too. We're not done. Have you take the SMART goals home with you to work on those if you don't finish them here. But this is what I want to do now. Is I want to, but wait, before we do that, you can come up, Dave. Is as I was talking, Miss Cindy had something that kind of popped into her head. So she wants to come up and read it.
Good morning again. My mind wanders, and it's not always the spiritual things. Oh, so I'm just saying, as Pastor Tracy was talking, I kind of live my life off of this song, and I think it came, I don't even know what year it came out, but it was by McFadden and Whitehead, and the song was called Ain't No Stopping Us Now. So I always put that to my own life, you know? So I wish I could sing it, but maybe I'll step to it. Ain't no stopping us now, we're on the move. Ain't no stopping us now, we've got the groove. There's been so many things that held us down, but now it looks like things are finally coming around. I know we've got a long, long way to go, and where we'll end up, I don't know. But we won't let nothing hold us back. We're putting ourselves together, we're polishing up our act. If you felt we've been held down before, I know you'll refuse to be held down anymore. Don't you let nothing, nothing stand in your way. I want you all to listen. Listen to what I have, every word I say. Ain't no stopping me now. I'm on the move. Yeah. I'm on the move. Yeah. Yeah.
There, you're dying to sing that, aren't you? So this is what I want us to do. I want us to have a moment at the altar. And I want you to take those things that you wrote down where you have settled, stopped and harangued. And I want you to bring them up to the altar and between you and God make a declaration. Ain't no stopping me now. I want to keep moving. And I give this to you to continue to stir in my heart and to keep me going and to keep me moving. I want to go to the land of Canaan in this little thing here. I want to keep moving in regards to this. Can we do that? All right. So we're going to take a few minutes to do that. Just come up. You can kneel. You can stand. You can just drop it And I want you to leave it at the altar, because what you're doing is, it's just a marker to go, God, I'm moving on these things. All right.
God, I look to you, I won't be overwhelmed. Give me vision to see things like you do. God, I look to you, you're where my help comes from. Give me wisdom. You know just what to do. God, I look to you. I won't be overwhelmed. Give me vision to see things like you do. God, I look to you. You're where my help comes from. Give me wisdom. You know just what to do. And I will love you, Lord, my strength. And I will love you, Lord, my shield. And I will love you, Lord, my rock. Forever all my days, I will love you, God. God, I look to you. I won't be overwhelmed. Give me vision to see things like you do. God, I look to you. You're where my help comes from. Give me wisdom. You know just what to do. And I will love you, Lord, my strength. And I will love you, Lord, my shield. I will love you, Lord, my rock. Forever all my days, I will love you, God. And I will love you, Lord, my strength. And I will love you, Lord, my shield. I will love you, Lord, my days, I will love you, Lord. Hallelujah, our God reigns. Hallelujah, our God reigns. Hallelujah, our God. Forever all my days, hallelujah. Let's
all stand and sing that together one more time.
Hallelujah, our God reigns. Hallelujah, our God reigns. Our God reigns forever all my days. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Our God reigns. Hallelujah. Our God reigns. God reigns.
Just a few announcements as we close out our service today. Our food pantry will be open out in the great room after service. If you or somebody you know is in need of some food pantry items, please stop in there and see Brittany, who will be over there. We have our sacred space gathering this Tuesday, October 17th at 7 o'clock p.m. in the library. So if you identify as part of the LGBTQIA+ community, we invite you out to that really sweet time, that group getting together. There's a ton of other things coming up and going on here, so I'm not going to go through all of them. I do want to highlight that the youth is going to start a online fundraiser with Joe Corby's. That starts tomorrow. So that information will go out on our weekly newsletter, which if you do not get yet, please see me after service so I can get your email to add you to that list. So it's just a nice synopsis of all these things that are coming up and going on with all the links to everything. So please see me after service to get on that list if you're not already. And if you are like Joe Corby's stuff, please order something in the next couple weeks to support our youth. And I'm going to let you announce the thing that's happening after service.
How was that for everybody? Was that good stuff? I went 17 minutes. That's like a miracle. It's a miracle, Matt. Are your daughters here? So we are, let's all stand for the benediction. And we invite everybody to come to our Cinnamon Roll Sunday. Woohoo! Thank you, Char, Piper. Thank you. Yay. And it's for the new members to welcome them in. So please go over there, out there in the great room, welcome them, give them hugs. So glad that they're a part of our community. So glad that y'all took that step. So thank you. So, Lord, we thank you so much for your whisper to us that invites us, keep going, keep coming, keep moving. We thank you that your love encompasses all of it. And the reason that you whisper for us to keep moving is because it's in following you, Lord. It's in following you that the greatest fulfillment of our life comes, and that you know what's best for us. So I just pray over all of these SMART goals. I pray over all of these areas where we have settled, and I pray for release. I pray for movement, and I pray, Lord, that we would take one step at a time and keep moving. I pray your blessings over each one. I pray your blessings over those new members that have become a part of our community today. And I pray your blessings over our fellowship around those delicious cinnamon rolls. And blessings over Shar as she continues to bring these to our community. Pray all these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Be blessed, everybody.